Okay, here is our first section that we are going to do in the MVP Integrated Math 1 curriculum. This is called 1.2 Growing Dots, and this is a develop understanding task. Now, in this activity, all they have given us is a very simple diagram right here. At the beginning, there was one dot. At 1 minute, there are five dots. And at 2 minutes, there are how many dots do you see there? You know how I see them? I see four branches with two dots each and then one dot in the middle. So 4 times 2 is 8 plus 1, there's 9 right there. So one more time. At the beginning, one dot. At 1 minute, five dots. And at 2 minutes, there were 9 dots. Now, we're going to take this diagram and we're going to use this and some modeling that we are about to do to answer these four questions. All right, so let's have fun. This could be one of our most important lessons in the year. I'm going to share you guys the data modeling frame, and we're going to use that to answer any question throughout this first semester. All right, so here it is, modeling data frame right there. Now, in algebra, we can take things, we can take data specifically and model it in many ways. These are the, how many are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the 6 most common ways to do that. And usually they're going to give us one of these models, and we're going to use the given model to create the other models, because with all these models, we can answer just about any question. So what did they give us in the activity? Let me go back. All they did is give us a simple diagram. Well, you don't have to re-put that into your model here because you have it right in your notes and stuff, all right? But I'm going to put it here so we can see it here, all right? You need to look in your MVP curriculum. And the first thing we're going to do is write a sequence of numbers. Typically, if we have a diagram, we will start with a sequence. And a sequence of numbers is nothing more than a set of points. And what it does, it's a set of points that gives us the outputs to a function. How many dots do we see at the beginning? That's right, 1. How many dots do we see at 1 minute? 5. How many dots do we see at 9 minutes? And I'll bet you guys could expand this too, even though you don't have the diagram anymore. Now, what's the difference between 1 and 5? We call that a common difference. And how far is it from 1 to 5? That's right, it is 4. What's the common difference from 5 to 9? Still 4. So 9 plus 4 would give us what number right here? That's right, 13. And you could expand this as far as you want as well. And by the way, this dot, dot, dot simply means and so on. This is my sequence of numbers, and this pattern with a common difference of 4 is going to go on and on and on and on. All right, now, a sequence is a great model. It is a simple model, but really, it just shows us outputs, 1, 5, and 9. Now, I go to a table next because a table shows me inputs and outputs. Remember the at the beginning, at 1 minute, at 2 minutes? Those are my inputs. Those are what I'm going to call x, and you could use any variable you want right there, n, t, whatever. All right, so I'm going to start at the beginning. What number makes sense for at the beginning? Do you think maybe 0? And then at 1 minute, 1. At 2 minutes, 2. And do you think this pattern is going to continue? Yes, it is. 3, you might go 4. And then, you know, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. How about we just go dot, 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 meaning again, just like over here, and so on. And I like to put my variable at the very bottom again too. This is my general term down here. So my input is x, and pretty soon we are going to have an expression for our output right there. Now, f of x. Well, these are back to the terms in my sequence, or the number of dots in each picture here. So at the beginning there was one dot. The sequence says the first output is 1. At 1 minute, there were 5 minutes, I see that. Or 5 dots, I see that here and here. And again, this just continues. 9, 13, let's take this one a little farther. 13 plus 4 would be 17, and so on. Now we're gonna save this expression down here for later when we get to it. All right, but there's my table. And really, the only part of the table I need is this section right in here, the numbers that I saw. Okay, now typically then I go from the table to the graph. Now this graph, okay, we only have, look at our input, 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4 and so on, and I have a lot of hash marks here. 1, 2, 3, 4, this goes a long way. So instead of going each hash mark by 1, how about we go by 1/2? And let's label this clearly so everybody sees that. How about if I put a 1 right here at the second hash mark? That makes every hash mark here worth 1/2. So that would put a 2 here, a 3 here, a 4 here, and I could keep going and going and going, but I can see it now pretty clearly, so I'll stop here. And besides, this is what I have in my table. Now, when I think about my outputs, those are my f of x values or my y values. They go on a vertical axis, okay? And let's count how many hash marks do we have here. Can I get to 17 here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. Yes, I can do it. So I'm just going to let every hash mark on the vertical axis, or we could call that the y axis, or the f of x axis, equal 1. And so I don't have to label these if they are just worth 1. But our first time here, so we can clearly see where we're plotting our points, let's do it. And I'm not going to label every one because I really don't have room. Okay, so I usually do something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. And then I'd go 19 and I'm off the grid. We'll leave it just like that. Now, let's plot our points. And I like to go from the table. So when x equals 0, f of 0 is 1. So x, remember, is my input. It's my horizontal axis. And that's a 0. F of x is my output on my vertical axis. And that's a 1. So here's the origin right here. This is point 0, 0. And when x equals 0, y equals 1. Put a point right there. Now, I could just continue to plot these points, but I want to make another point. Remember our common difference of 4? That's the difference between the terms in my sequence, making this, by the way, an arithmetic sequence, which we'll get into later. So the common difference of an arithmetic sequence is the same as the slope of a linear equation. So D always equals M. And I think you guys all know what M is, or slope of a linear equation, is from last year. If my slope is 4, that means from any point to get to another point, I can go up 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, and over. Be careful, that's 1/2. 1 right there. And now instead of looking at my table, I can just do that. 1, 2, 3, 4, and over 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, and over 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, and over 1. And if I did that again, I'd be off my graph, so I'll stop right there. There's my graph. That is a scatter plot of points. All right. Now next, we need to do an explicit formula. And do you agree that it looks like this scatter plot is forming a straight line? Guess what? An arithmetic sequence will always give you a graph that is a scatter plot forming a straight line. That means my explicit formula would be a linear function, all right? And we used last year y equals mx plus b for the linear equation of a line. Y equals mx plus b. And you know the parts of this. M is the slope and b is the y-intercept. So that implies my explicit formula is f of x equals m, which we see it up here as a 4. I see it in the difference between terms right here, 4. And I see it in the difference of my outputs over here, 4. All right? 1 plus 4 is 5, and so on. And I even see it in my graph right here. I'm rising 1, 2, 3, 4, and I am running 1. 4 over 1 is 4. Straight line. There's the slope, again, to anywhere, and I could start right here and go 1, 2, 3, 4, and over 1 half 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, over 1 half 1, and so on. Now, B is the y-intercept, and you see that everywhere here. I think I see it easiest in my table, when x equals 0, y equals 1, okay? Or f of x equals 1 in my table, all right? So, the place where a graph crosses the y-axis is when x equals 0, so you see it right there in the graph, too. The y-intercept is 1, okay? Now, only one more thing to do. By the way, though, f of x equals 4x plus 1, do you remember what I promised you? You see my table, f of x. Guess what I'm going to put at the very bottom? When my input is x, my output f of x will always equal 4 times x plus 1. Put that right there. Great! Okay, now, last part. And this is the easiest part. It's going to seem a little abstract today because I don't think you have ever seen this before, but we are going to do a recursive formula. And recursive formulas are used a lot by computer programmers. It's easier to create, maybe a little harder to use, right? And it has two parts. A recursive formula has an initial condition in function notation, and then it has a recursion equation. So I started it like this every time. Every time I see recursive formula, I write this. Now, remember what I said the first part was? The initial condition in function notation. That is easiest to see in our table. Do you see the point 0, 1? I also see that here. I also see it right here. At the beginning, there was one dot. And I even see it at the beginning of my sequence, I have a 1. So in function notation, we write the coordinates of that point 0, 1 right there. F of 0 equals 1. That is my initial condition in function notation. And then we go to the recursion equation. This is a little more complicated. It is f of x, or any term I'm looking for, will always be the previous term, and in function notation, the notation for the previous term or the previous output is f of x minus 1. So if I'm looking for f of x, all right, I use f of x minus 1. So here's what that really means. If x is 2, then f of 2 would be that 9 right there. So 9 equals f of x minus 1. Well, if x is 2, 2 minus 1 is 1. F of 1, which is 5 plus how many more? And again, what are we adding every time? 1 plus 4 is 5. 5 plus 4 is 9. 9 plus 4 is 13. 13 plus 4 is 17. All right, you see that clearly in the table. You also see it. The common difference of my arithmetic sequence is 4 right there. So I'm just going to take the previous term and add 4 every time to get the term I'm looking for. That is a recursive formula, and we're going to work with those every day. This model right there is going to become the easiest model you ever do. All right, but it might look a little abstract right now, and that's okay. So these are the 6 models of the data given. They gave us the diagram, and we use that to create everything else. And these 6 models will answer any question algebraically. I hope you had as much fun as I just did. All right, so let's get back to the activity where we see the questions and the diagram that they gave us right here. Now, wouldn't it be great if we could use our models to answer all of those questions rather easily? Well, let's see if we can do that. So here's our models right here. That's a great document that we just created, and I want to know, can I look at those models and easily describe the pattern that you see in the sequence of figures above, which is now below, it's right here in our picture. But anyway, let's use it. Now, what we are looking for here is, do you see a common difference of 4? Do you see it in the diagram, 1 dot to 5 dots to 9 dots? Do you see it in the sequence, 1 goes to 5, 5 goes to 9, 9 goes to 13? Do you see it in the table, outputs, 1 goes to 5, 5 goes to 9, 9 goes to 13, 13 goes to 17, note the plus 4 every time. You even see it over here in the graph with our slope. To get from this point, I am rising 1, 2, 3, 4, and I'm running 1 half 1, and that will work every time. 1, 2, 3, 4, running 1 half and 1. Okay, and then I see it in my explicit formula, f of x equals 4 times x plus 1. What is this for? It is the slope, which is the same thing as the common difference. And then we even see it in our recursive formula. Look at our recursion equation on the very bottom. Any f of x will always equal f of x minus 1, the previous term, plus 4. It is everywhere. So let's answer the question. Describe the pattern that you see in the sequence of figures above. There is a common difference between terms of, and what is that common difference again? It is 4. And you could write it out like that, or you could just say d equals, what's the common difference? 4. Number 2. Assuming the pattern continues in the same way, how many dots are there at 3 minutes? Now, I would answer this with a table. Personally, in 3 minutes there will be blank dots. Well, do you see x equals 3, f of x equals 13 right there? That means that when x is 3, or at the third minute mark, at the beginning, 1 minute, 2 minutes, when x is 3, at 3 minutes there will be 13 dots. And you're moving on to the next question. Now, I'd like to stress some of the other models here, so let's see if we see it everywhere. Could we have drawn a diagram and said, like, at 3 minutes and drawn that picture? You could have. It would not have been very efficient, but you definitely could have done that there. The sequence, this is the 0 at the beginning. So the input is 0, the output is 1. And at 1 minute, we're at 5. At 2 minutes, we're at 9. I see it right there. At 3 minutes, we are at 13, and so on. So we see it there. Look at the graph over here. X equals 3. What's the y value of this point right there? Well, let's write down the coordinates of that point. When x equals 3, f of x equals 13. And we write that as an ordered pair. The x always goes first. X comma y is, x is 3, and y is 13. I see it there. Now, I could even use my explicit formula. F of x equals 4x plus 1. Let's do this like this. Instead of f of x, let's say I want in 3 minutes, f of 3 equals, and then I write my expression, but see the x right there? I now have to replace it with this 3 right here. And help me out. 4 times 3, 12, plus 1 more, 13. Alright, now the one model I wouldn't use for a question like this is the recursive formula. This is for a computer programmer, and I could use it, but I'd have to write down every term. F of 0 is 1. F of 1 is 1 plus 4 more, 5. F of 2 is 5 plus 4 more, 9. It's just shorthand for our table over here. I would not use the recursive formula to answer a question like this, but I could use everything else pretty easily. Number 3, how many dots are there at 100 minutes? 100 minutes. When my input is a very large number, like 100 or 500, something like that, all right, that we typically, if we look at our models, we don't see it immediately. Like, could you imagine drawing out this diagram to get to not at 2 minutes, but to at 100 minutes? That'd be a lot of drawing. That would take many days. You could do it, but it would take a long time. Can you imagine expanding our sequence? Remember, this is a zero term, the first term, the second term, the third term. So if I was going to answer this question with my sequence, I would have to have 101 terms. The 101st term, because this is the zero term, would give me my output. Not very efficient. My table, I would have to expand both inputs and outputs to use my table. And my graph, I'm nowhere near an x value of 100 here. All right. And remember, the recursive formula is simply computer shorthand for the inputs and outputs of my table. That's not going to work very well either. But then there's my explicit formula right there. When my input is large, I'm going to go directly to my explicit formula. And f of x becomes f of 100. And if my x is 100, that means the other side would be 4 times x, which is now we substitute our 100 plus 1 more. 4 times 100 is 400 plus 1 more, 401. And that would be 401 dots too. Now, let me go back here. I did not write down dots, and I should have. I am so sorry. So make sure you write 401 dots. How many dots are there at 100 minutes? I don't want just the 401 right there. Okay, let's go to our very last problem. How many dots are there at T minutes? Okay. Now, again, they're just asking for our explicit formula, but they're not using an x like we did. They're using a t. So let's just rewrite our explicit formula in terms of t. See that right there? 4, and instead of an x, I'm going to use a t, 4t plus 1. So I'm going to write the whole function out. F of now, let's use a t, will equal 4t plus 1. And you know, you could write dots there too, 4t plus 1 dots. That would be great. In fact, I'd love to see that. All right, that is our first activity in Integrated Math 1.2, Growing Dots. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you saw how powerful our modeling data can be. Makes it really easy to answer questions. You guys have a great day. And by the way, now it's your time to get the ready, set, go for section 1.2 done. That is right in your IM1 notebook. Thank you.